Today, we will consult three great sources of wisdom, Ezekiel, Matthew, and Brené. That's Brené Brown. They all have something to tell us about being resilient. Our two Bible readings today are both pretty long, and for those who have a lengthy church experience, they may sound familiar, even a little famous. Anne even thinks she read this before from the pulpit many moons ago. The reading from Ezekiel is about the dry bones coming back to life, so it is tied into themes of resurrection. The Matthew text is about the judgment day and the final judgment. These two tropes, resurrection and judgment, have been central to the faith for a long time, and they both need re-examination. As Presbyterians, we are part of the Reformed tradition. We are always working to be effective in our understanding of ancient texts. And our engagement with the text is that much richer because we learn the difference between what it meant then to them and what it means now to us. This stretch of Ezekiel was written and taught at a difficult time in the life of the people of Israel. They were in exile. They had been conquered by the Babylonians. So it makes sense for us that during this season of Lent, we will profit most by grounding this prophetic visionary experience, this ecstatic poetic vision, in Israel's time in exile. God's people have lost their most essential theological realities: the land, the temple, and the monarchy. All the things they were taught that they got directly from God. They find themselves buried in a theological crisis. The connections for their relationship with God have been severed. Dry bones all around. Their traditional theologies, based on God's covenants with Moses and with David, are falling apart. Mount Zion, home of the temple, is no longer the home for God and God's people. This new experience of exile demands a rethinking of God and God's dealings with his people, a God that can follow them to Babylon. How could God allow such a disaster to occur to his people? Where is God during this devastation and loss? Well, in this vision, God says to the mortal, prophesy to these bones. That is, speak prophetically. Speak of the spiritual truth of the urgent power of God. And say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, to these bones I will cause breath, the spirit, to enter you, and you shall live. God is saying, speak the truth of God into the dusty, dry, dead bones of your faith, and God will breathe the Holy Spirit into them. The Spirit is as close to us as our breath. It is indeed the breath of God. Or as Jesus says when he has healed someone, your faith has made you well. Now, the old ways of reading this has given us a habit we still cling to, where it says this, thus says the Lord, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves. A lot of people are buried in a lot of cemeteries, expecting Jesus in a short period of time. All that time has passed. All those people are still buried. Yet there has been no resurrection, no second coming, no judgment day. Maybe it is not too early to get rid of these ideas as something to believe in literally. I certainly think we can be more practical and look at them as poetic stories, like parables, that carry truth and meaning, even if they are not literally true. Let's look at the dry bones again. We work on building resilience in ourselves so that we may withstand the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. We have to be durable, and our faith has to be durable because it is one of the things that can help sustain us. And on bad days, we need to know where to turn. The message here is, speak the word of God in prayer and in our life, and God will fill you with the Spirit, the breath of God, and bring our old dry bones back to life. I will put my Spirit within you, and you shall live. I will place you on your own turf. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I will act. God encourages us to act on our faith, to speak our faith to ourselves and to each other. Our gospel reading has been misinterpreted to be about God or Jesus sitting in judgment on everyone. This concept is a very good enforcement mechanism. We have a picture of God or Jesus as a king who can see into our hearts, kind of like what we do to kids at Christmas time. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows when you've been bad or good, so be good for goodness sake. Oh! That's a great motivation so that the congregation lives in fear. We are told again and again to not be afraid. Be not afraid. But it doesn't matter when we have a story like this to fire up our anxiety and the paranoia. God will get you for that. It's also something we fondly hope for when we look around us. We hope that there's justice. We hope that there's judgment. So as much as we are scared, we also hope it is true. That's how it has been taught to us. We are shamed into living in fear. Let's look at it in a less literal way, a more thoughtful way. The story is a parable, and a good one. It's a puzzle that includes the kind of twists that are typical of the other parables of Jesus. It is also a trap. Readers wander into it thinking that we'll be able to figure out how we will be counted among the sheep, only to discover that the very attempt locates us within goat territory. Two aspects of context are especially important. First, the parable corresponds to the Beatitudes, which you'll find in Matthew 3, blessed are the meek. So they served as bookends for the teachings of Jesus in Matthew. Matthew is often called the teaching gospel because it is well written as an instruction manual. Like the Beatitudes, this parable describes the essential values and practices that define those who participate in the realm of God. Here on earth, in this life. Second, it is within the more immediate context of Matthew's discourse about the end times. The end times is a major preoccupation of the Judean people at this point in time. One assumption was that if God is just, then the injustice of the Roman occupation cannot continue forever. And God will come down and intervene and judge the wicked and the good, and then 1,000 years of peace will reign. That's what Revelation is all about. The Jews and the Essenes believed in this. This belief was then transferred onto the beliefs of Jesus. This image of a king in judgment is part of that landscape. It is the capstone of this long, winding answer that Jesus gave to the question his disciples asked. As Jesus ends his occupation of the temple and prophesies its destruction. What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age, they ask in Matthew 24. Jesus answers in many ways, violent chaos, cosmic portents. But the most important answer is, no one knows. That's the one we have to remember. Everyone who says they know doesn't seem to remember this verse. I've had to confront people who've been told a date and a time and say, hey, Jesus says no one knows. In this parable, we learn that the coming Son of Man has been present all along among the most vulnerable members of the society. And Son of Man means a human being, son of a man, a person, not the Son of God, not an angelic being, a human. The Son of Man comes in all his glory. Son of Man of this parable overturns the paradigms of power and makes his dwelling place among the least. Apparently, the king, the Son of Man, has not merely been present in disguise among the least of these. Rather, he is one of them. As James Cohn says, if God understands the suffering of Jesus on the cross, then God understands the sufferings of us. This is the first shock of this parable. The second shock comes when he tried to determine who the least ones are. The parable explicitly confirms the criteria of who compassion goes through. They are enumerated as the hungry and thirsty, the stranger like immigrants, the naked or destitute, those without protection, or even the bare necessities. The sick, which can be someone with an illness, or those sick at heart, or those with mental illness. And who is more destitute than people with mental illness? And then those in prison, and that can be the prison of illness, prison of poverty, prison of loneliness, or the overstuffed for-profit prison system that we have that puts Black people in jail to create white jobs in small-town America. I am haunted by those prisoners for shame. That's not a long list, but it's long enough. It's enough to keep us busy. We know clearly what to do, but for whom shall we do it? Who are the least ones? Is it the Christian community itself only? A narrow target group would help also help keep the project manageable. Others argue that compassion should be directed to anyone in need, Christian or not, thereby creating a much larger pool of potential least ones. Why didn't Jesus give his disciples a clearer identification of the least ones? Maybe. Because if we start talking about who qualifies for our compassion and who doesn't, then doing so would turn us more and more into goats. Now, we can never do enough. We know that. But how do we avoid beating ourselves up because there is so much suffering in the world? The church is often mocked as feeble and ineffective. We're not going to be able to measure up to Jesus being all over the place all the time. Sometimes we are ashamed of what we have left undone. And sometimes our faith tradition can try to generate shame as a means of social control. When they say, give till it hurts, That means you have not given enough. And they teach us as hospital chaplains that our ability to help is finite, but the world's needs are infinite. They don't teach that at church often enough. I'm against shame. So is Brené Brown. Brené Brown is a Texas sociologist who researches shame, vulnerability, and courage. You can watch her for free on a YouTube video, a TED Talk called The Power of Vulnerability. I totally recommend it. She speaks very candidly about struggling with shame as she researches it. She says, shame can be so powerful that I would engineer smallness into my life. I thought, that sounds very familiar. So she did this Houston TED Talk about vulnerability. She was not expecting it to do very well. And she felt so vulnerable giving the presentation that she felt ashamed of herself afterwards. She had a shame hangover. And she thought, well, at least no one's going to see it. I mean, 500 people from Houston, where I teach, I know about 100 of them, that'll be it. That was the crowd at the lecture. So she went to check on how it was doing. And she found out it was on YouTube and to see how many views it was getting. And it was 3 people. 4 people, 5 million, 6 million. It exploded. Went through the roof. Her husband said, don't read the comments. And she promised not to, and then went and started reading the comments. The fear of shame and criticism was powerful. The comments were the worst. Like, less research, more Botox. Of course she embraces imperfection. What choice do you have when you look like that? I hope someone kills her. She's what's wrong with the world today. On and on. Then she tried to turn professional. She has a PhD, after all. She said, I'm prepared for this moment. You are in a shame storm. You know what to do. Peanut butter and Downton Abbey. She watched it for 7 hours. It's what she calls numbing with video. Then, when it's over and you still don't want to go back to the real world, you get out the laptop and start to look stuff up, like, where is this Abbey? How do you get there? Do you fly into Heathrow? How much does that cost? Then it got to, who is the president of the United States during this Downton Abbey thing? And she found out it was Teddy Roosevelt. She said, I'm doing anything I can to avoid going back to Houston, Texas, and my life and the haters. Then I had a total God moment. God descending into my living room in full regalia. And I read a speech that Teddy Roosevelt gave that changed my life. It's a famous speech. Teddy Roosevelt said this. It's not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes up short again and again. Because there is no effort without error or shortcomings. But who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, he who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at worst, if he fails, at least he fails while daring greatly. End quote. And daring greatly became the title of her next book and her Netflix special, where this story comes from. I'm recommending these videos to Chuck for the morning of the adult ed and to you. Brené Brown says, there's my life before that quote and my life after that quote. It was a total God moment. There's no other way to explain it. She says, there were three things that became clear to me in that speech that were life-altering. One, I'm going to live in the arena. I will be brave with my life. I'm going to show up. I'm going to take chances. And I can tell you this for sure. If you are brave with your life, if you're going to live in the arena, you're going to get your ass kicked. You're going to fail. You're going to fall. You're going to know heartbreak. It's a choice I make every day. Today, I will choose courage over comfort. Today, I will choose to be brave. And I know what that means. And I do all these workshops with leaders and organizations. And the leaders will say, I hear you. And I'm going to be brave. And I'm going to risk failing. And I say, no, you don't hear me. You're not hearing me. Somewhere between what I am saying and what you are hearing, you are taking out, you're going to fail. You're going to know failure if you are brave with your life. Second, that quote is everything I know about vulnerability. Vulnerability is when you choose to show up when you can't control the outcome. Vulnerability is not weakness. Vulnerability is our most accurate way to measure courage. We can measure how brave you are by how vulnerable you are willing to be. There is no courage without vulnerability. Third, if you're not in the arena getting your ass kicked on occasion because you're being brave, I am not interested in or open to your feedback about my work. There are millions of people who will never enter once, who will never once step into the arena, but they will make a full-time job of throwing criticism and judgment and really hateful things at us. We have to get out of the habit of grabbing those things and holding them to our hearts. I recommend all of our stuff. It's about expanding perception. To me, that is a God thing. That is the Holy Spirit thing. That is what Jesus is about, helping the blind to see, freeing people from what imprisons them, healing the sick. That's what we do, the best of our abilities. And I'm no longer listening to those who say our church isn't doing enough, because other churches are not doing enough. Because the dogs bark, the caravan moves on. Dear God, we feel so small in the face of war, pestilence, tornadoes, hurricanes, and hunger. We feel accused because of the failures of the church as a whole. But we are not gods. Teddy Roosevelt also said, do what you can with what you have where you are. And that is a good Republican motto and a good Christian motto too. All this we thank you for. Amen.